Welcome to Southwest Philadelphia Seventh-day Adventist Church. It's a joy to have you worship with us today. Newcomers and returning members alike, may you find inspiration, comfort, and a sense of belonging to uplift and bless your day.
Thank you. situation, they could raise their hand with a little arthritis. Some aren't raising it at all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to give them everything that I have this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The words to this song say rejoice in him. Hallelujah. We're going to rejoice in the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, 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 it's a war chant. Oh, come on, sing that way, sing. Sing, Lord. You might as well sing it with us. Oh, come on, sing, Lord. Come on, let's get a war cry going in here. Sing, oh, hey. Come on, somebody good. Sing, oh, oh. Sing, oh, that's it, sing, oh. Come on, sing it one more time. Sing, oh,
gonna dance. I'm gonna dance and praise him.
It doesn't matter what comes.
It doesn't matter what comes.
The greater one.
The greater one lives inside of me.
His name is Jesus.
His name is Jesus.
I'm born a winner.
I'm born a winner.
More than victorious.
More than victorious.
I'm the heir of his kingdom.
I'm the heir of his kingdom.
Filled with the Holy Ghost.
Filled with the Holy Ghost.
Come on, if you came determined in your spirit that you're going to give God glory this morning. Let's say that again.
I'm going to dance. I'm going to dance and praise him.
It doesn't matter what.
It doesn't matter what comes my
the
way.
The greater one.
The greater one lives inside of me.
His name is Jesus.
His name is Jesus.
I'm born a winner.
I'm born a winner.
More than victorious.
More than victorious.
I'm a
I'm in heaven.
Come on now. Filled with the Holy Ghost.
Filled with the Holy Ghost.
Rejoice in him.
Rejoice in him.
Rejoice.
Rejoice in him.
Rejoice.
Rejoice in him.
More than a conqueror.
More than a conqueror.
Rejoice in him.
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 Rejoice.
More than a
conqueror.
More than a conqueror. Oh, 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 oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
than a conqueror.
More 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 than a conqueror.
Come on, are you more than a conqueror this morning? Hallelujah. Come on, we are victorious over it all. Hallelujah. Say more than victorious.
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 Oh, oh, oh. Sing.
Oh, 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 oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh. Come on, where are my warrior Christians at? Come on, sing
oh. Oh, 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 oh.
Come on, get a war cry coming off. Where are all our soldiers on the battlefield?
Oh, 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 oh,
oh. Hey! One last time, sing oh.
Conquerors.
Hallelujah. That means you're not going to make it through the battle crawling. You're going to be walking. We're more than conquerors. I'm not just going to crawl over the finish line. I'm going to walk myself over the finish line because I'm more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Some of us are giving the devil too much credit over our lives. Hallelujah. I'm going to be more than a conqueror over this sickness. I'm going to be more than a conqueror in my marriage. I'm going to be more than a conqueror through my finances. Hallelujah. 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 You might as well come lift up the name of Jesus with us. I feel God good this morning. Say, high lifted up.
High lifted up in all the earth is who you are.
High lifted up.
High lifted up in all the earth is who you are.
High lifted up.
High lifted up in all the earth is who you are.
Lord, we exalt.
Lord, we exalt your name.
Lord, we exalt.
Lord, we exalt your name.
Oh, Lord.
We love you.
Oh, Lord.
We love you.
Oh, Lord.
We love you.
Oh, Lord.
up,
high and lifted 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 up,
oh Lord, we love,
we love,
oh Lord,
oh Lord,
we love,
we love, oh Lord,
we love,
we love,
oh Lord,
oh Lord.
Oh Lord,
oh Lord,
we bless you.
We bless you.
Oh Lord,
oh Lord,
we bless you.
We bless you.
Oh Lord,
we bless you.
Oh Lord,
we bless you.
Oh Lord,
we love you.
We love you.
Oh Lord,
we bless you.
We bless you.
Oh Lord,
we bless you.
We bless you.
Oh Lord, I lift it up.
Oh Lord,
we bless you.
We bless you.
Oh Lord,
we love you.
We love you.
Oh Lord,
we pray.
We pray.
Oh Lord,
oh Lord,
I lift it up.
High and lifted up,
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 high and lifted up.
He sits high, high and lifted up,
but he looks down on
high and lifted up,
high and lifted up,
high and lifted up,
high and lifted up,
high and lifted up.
There's nobody like him.
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 High and lifted up.
High and lifted up.
High and lifted up.
Church say amen, everybody. Let the church say amen. Let us all stand. Let us all stand and give him all the praise, the honor, and the glory. For he is worthy to be praised. Amen, amen, amen. We will turn in our Bibles to Psalm 103, verses 1 to 10. Psalm 103, verses 1 to 10. And we are going to read alternately, but when we read, we're going to read with emphasis as though God has done something for us this morning. Amen. So I will begin and then you will go. We'll read alternately. It says, bless the Lord. Amen, somebody. Oh, my soul and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Come on. Let's get to one now. It says, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases,
who redeemeth thy life from destruction,
who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies,
who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles.
The Lord executed righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed.
He made known his ways unto Moses, his acts unto the children of Israel.
The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and plenteous in mercy.
He will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. Let's all read together. He hath not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. Amen, amen. Heavenly Father, we, your children, come into your courts this morning, unworthy though we be, but you have sent your Son to die on the cross for us. And so for this morning, we come asking you to forgive us of our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and please to hear and answer our prayers. Come now and tabernacle in this place so that we can see you high and lifted up, and that we will worship you in spirit and in truth. Take this service now, dear Father, that whatever will be said or done here today will be done in accordance with your will. Father, we bless your name, and we thank you, and we praise you. In Jesus' worthy name, let the church say, amen, amen, and amen, amen, amen. And let us turn in our song books now, because we're going to sing the praises of God. Song number 499, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. need to put your hands together and make that noise. Come on, let's praise the Lord this morning. What a friend we have in Jesus, everyone.
What a friend we have in Jesus. Yeah. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry.
All the men on the next dance. What a friend. Come on, man. Every trials and temptation. Come on. Okay, all the men together now. Come on, man. Let's sing all those bases. Come on. Together all now.
Every trials and temptation.
Is there trouble anywhere? Is there trouble anywhere? Into the Lord. Come on, can we find a friend so faithful, man?
Can we find a friend so faithful? Who will all our sorrows share? Jesus, hold our every weakness.
Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Into the Lord.
All right, ladies, respond in the third verse now. Are we?
Are we weak and heavy laden? But with the Lord of care, precious Savior, still our refuge. Take it to the Lord.
One more time. Are we weak and heavy laden? All together now.
Are we weak and heavy laden? Come with the Lord of death. Precious Savior, still our
come on, let's take it all.
To thy friends despise forsake me. Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms you'll take and shield me. Thou will find a solace there.
Let's hold it, 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 praise the Lord, somebody, praise the Lord.
church say amen. Amen. Oh, let the church say amen. Amen. I kind of believe you want to have church today. I know God is already here. I know his presence is in the place. I know the Holy Spirit is moving. And he'll move even if we don't move. Amen. So praise God. From whom all blessings flow. Amen. Oh, I don't think we got it good. Amen. Come on. When you say amen, you say, I'm right with God. Amen. Amen. Come on, Elder. Because we got a hot something to tell you.
Amen. 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 Good morning, everyone. Come on, you can do better than that. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I stand before you this morning as the Pathfinder director. Our Pathfinders are getting ready to go on one of the largest campery in all the world.
Yes.
Over 55,000. The tickets are sold out. We do not have enough tickets for people who need tickets. We want our children here, our Pathfinders here, to have that experience. Amen, somebody? Now, what we're coming to you, first of all, we want to say, Southwest, you are the bomb.
Yeah.
You have been very supportive of all of the fundraisers that we have been having. You have showed up in many of them, and some of you, from the day we announced it, you have been given financially almost every week. And for that, we want to thank you. And after I can promise you this, after the campery, we as a Pathfinder Club will find a way of honoring the entire church for the deeds that you have done for us. Now, when I initially came to you, do you remember how much money we needed? $100,000, right? Okay.
We need
how much?
$100,000.
$100,000. Okay. Now, can we attain it?
Yes.
All right. All right. We just said, what a friend we have in Jesus. We just sang it, right? We are to bring all our griefs and bears to anything that we need, we ought to bring it to Jesus. So here's what we're going to have you do. As a church, I want you to pray for our Pathfinders and our young people. Amen? But specifically, I want you to pray that God will give us the $100,000.
Pastor, they don't believe.
Do you believe? You just sang the song. Take it to the Lord in prayer. We need $100,000. So here's what we're going to do. So far, through your generous contributions, you don't have to find $100,000. You have already provided $30,000 to our young people. But it's not a sprint, it's a marathon. Amen, somebody. So you have been contributing, and we are so excited about what you have done. But we are going to ask you to go on a faith walk with God this morning. You know why? Because our young people are always questioning about God. What better way to show them that God is a practical God? No matter how small it is, no matter how big the problem is, it says come to him in prayer and believe. Do we believe that we will get the other $70,000? All right. So what it is that we have envelopes. Lightbearers Pathfinder Club for Gillette. And we're going to ask everyone in here to take an envelope and to put in just $100.
Yes.
Oh, some people stop talking. Okay. Remember, it's a faith walk. It's a faith walk. Yes. I'm not the prosperity gospel type.
Yes.
You know, I'm not going to tell you that you're going to get $200,000 if you give God $100,000. That's between you and God. All I'm saying is that the Pathfinders need it. We are your young people. And we believe and we are praying that God will give it to you to help us to get to Gillette. So I was hoping that the envelopes would be here. We're going to give you the envelopes. We're going to give you a month. So the second week in May, we're going to come back. And we want testimonies. We not just want your money, but we want you to tell us how God blessed you to bless his young people. Amen. Because you see, sometimes we get the blessings and we keep it quiet. That is not what the blessing is for, is to let people know that we are praying to a God who hears and answers our prayers. So when they have their problems, they can take you to the Lord in prayer, understanding that he's gonna already bless them, somebody. So come on with a faith walk with us in the Light Bearers Pathfinders Club and see how God is gonna bless us this morning. God bless you, everyone. And we look forward to God blessing you and blessing us in this journey to Gillette. God bless you, everyone.
Amen. God bless you. God bless you, Elder. It's a faith walk, my brothers and sisters. It's a faith walk. And how big is your faith? But my God is bigger than my faith. Amen. Amen. Just want to let you know this morning that I was given permission as well as an order. Dear church family, words cannot express just how much I appreciate your cards, your prayers, your phone calls, your texts, your meals that you sent by my husband, and gifts, and even medical advice. God has been so good to me, and I cannot begin to tell you just how much, but I can say to you, truly, I appreciate all of you, and I never stop praying for you. Amen. Says, God bless you all. And that was Sister Robin Blackwell. Amen. Amen. Please, please, I'm asking you again. Many of you were not here at the early announcement, but Pastor Mark McCleary and his lovely wife, Pat, are asking us to pray for his son, the middle boy, Brian, Michael Brian Michelle. Brian Michael, well, Brian, the oldest boy, has been diagnosed with stage 3 cancer. So we want to lift them up in prayer. Amen. And I mentioned to him that I believe that his former church will pray for him and that they will keep him and his son in their prayers. Amen. This is another faith walk. Either you believe in God or you haphazardly don't believe in God. I'm saying I believe in God. And I'm going to claim it that when I see that little big knucklehead again, I am just going to hug him tight as I can, knowing that God is taking care of him. And he will take care of him. And he will answer our prayers. Amen. So please, don't stop. Don't stop praying for Brian. Amen. Amen. May God richly bless us this blessed Sabbath day. And again, it's so good to have each and every one of you here. Please remember that the third Sabbath is Children's Chapel. We're still on third Sabbath, Sister Jackson? Third Sabbath. So when the announcements begin or we welcome our children are to go downstairs on the third Sabbath. And on the fifth Sabbath, they got the whole place. Amen. The children are collecting. I just want to remind us that on tomorrow, 10 o'clock to 12, we're having the viewing for the Matthias father, husband, grandfather, great-grandfather. Amen. And the funeral will follow at 12 o'clock. There was something else I said. Ah! All April babies, I know. All April babies, please stand up. All April babies. I know one is going to raise their hand. Her birthday is the 23rd. Amen, Brother Owen. All April babies. Memphis, today is Memphis' birthday. The little guy right there. As you see him coming up in that nice little bow tie. That's Memphis. I'm going to say this to you. This is his. Come here, Memphis. Come. This is his birthday. Amen. So remember, there's always nice to give a little remuneration. Amen. Just to let him know he's special today. Amen. He's already hit me, so I know I got to take care of him. Amen. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, April babies in Memphis. Happy birthday to you.
Morning, boys and girls. Good morning, boys and girls. Okay, let's stand up for a word of prayer. Let's just thank Jesus for the offering. You want to pray? Okay.
Bow your heads and close your eyes. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for watching over us through the week. I thank you for everybody here. I pray that you will cover the Matthias family, that you will make them happy again, and that you keep, and that everybody will keep them in prayer. I pray for the Smith family. I pray for everybody who even lost loved ones or are sick or anything happened to them. In Jesus' name, amen.
And thank you, Lord, for the offering that was given today. We ask you, Lord, that it will help towards the children's ministry. Amen. Okay, well, I have a true story to tell you today. Would you like to hear it? Okay, so it's called The New Backpack. Tell me, put your hands up if you own a backpack. I know I do. I got a few of them. All right, everybody's hand was up. Okay, The New Backpack. You're going to be walking a long way, my mother had said. I'd like my son to have a good backpack. It was going to be my first trip to Mexico to visit the Mitex Indians. Many of them live in far-off villages scattered through the hills of Oaxaca, Mexico. My mother was right. Just to get to the village where the Bible conference was to be held, we would have to walk for many hours over the hills. Mother kindly bought me the best backpack she could find. It was so light that you could lift it with one finger. And it had foam padding on the straps to keep the straps from cutting into my shoulders. When it was packed with extra clothes, some medicine, and a few other things that I might need, I tried the new backpack on. Sure, that was fine. I could carry that load easily, I thought. A few weeks later, we arrived in Mexico at the point where we would begin the hike. Could I carry your pack for you? Asked one of the Christian Indians. No, thanks. I'm fine, I told him. So we started off on the long walk. The backpack worked nicely, but the longer we walked, the heavier it got. Surely those things I had packed weren't so heavy when I had tried it on at home. On we walked with the hot sun beating on our heads, up the one hill and down the other. Everyone had loads to carry now, so there was no one to offer to help with my backpack. I began to be afraid that I would never make it. But after 2 hours, someone came to meet us over the hills with a horse. This time, when they offered, I gladly gave up the pack, and it was tied to the horse. I was so tired that it didn't matter to me that the padded straps on my new backpack was not being used the way they were meant to be, but were dangling from the horse's saddle. Well, many times since I have warned boys and girls that the load of sin is like the load in my backpack. The longer you carry it, the heavier it gets. This world tries to make sin look attractive, but it is still a heavy load. Well, boys and girls, I'm going to read the rest of the story in a minute, but guess what? I have a backpack. And I want to see, I don't want you to put it on your backs, but I just want to see who think that it can hold this backpack. Let's see. Destiny, can you lift that backpack? Oh, you can try with one hand. Oh, okay. All right, thank you. So, I just said that many times since I have warned boys and girls that the load of sin is like the load in my backpack. The longer you carry it, the heavier it gets. So, just like the backpack that was heavy, the longer you carry it, the heavier it gets, right? So, you know, boys and girls, if we harbor sin in our hearts, it is just like that heavy backpack. Do you want to know what kind of sins that we can harbor in our hearts? I'm going to tell you. I'm going to open my backpack. What kind of sin is that? Who can tell me? Come to the mic and say it nice and loud, because this is a heavy.
Unforgiveness.
Okay, that was in the backpack, right? All right, here's another one. Who wants to read this one? Come on.
Jealousness.
Jealousy, yes. That was another sin. Okay, let's look at another one. This is heavy. Who wants to read this one? Come on.
Being selfish.
Amen. Being selfish. One, two, three. And I think I have one more. All right. Who hasn't read yet? Come on.
Being dishonest.
Yes, being dishonest. Okay. So do you see that these sins can weigh us down? Just like the backpack was heavy for the boy that was carrying it. Do you see that these things can weigh us down if we harbor them in our hearts, right? Right. So, no matter how light your load of sin may feel when you are young, it will get heavier as you grow older. After a while, the foam padding of pleasure no longer eases the weight of sin. The Lord Jesus came into this world to free you from the load of sin. Do you believe that? Yes. He himself carried the load of sin when he was on the cross, so that you might be free of your burden forever. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many. And that's found in Hebrews 9:28. Oh, that you might, here's another text, and then I'm going to close. Oh, that you might today feel the weight of your sins and turn to Christ for salvation. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Matthew 11:28. And the person who wrote this story said, my backpack was the best that money could buy, but it could not keep my load from being heavy when I carried it for a long time. May you accept, boys and girls, Christ as your Savior now while you are young, before the load of sin becomes too heavy for you to carry. Amen? All right. So who would like now to come together? Let us come together and let us have a little talk with Jesus about the story, just to thank him. All right, come on over. Can we make a circle? I like it when we are all in one. Come on. All right, you're going to pray and then you're going to close, okay?
Bow your heads and close your eyes. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for God, everybody here safely. We thank you for letting everybody I hope that everybody have a great day. Amen.
Bow your heads and close your eyes. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day, and I thank you for waking us up, and I thank you for bringing us all safely to church, and I thank you for food on our table, for clothes on our bags, for roof over our heads, for our family and our friends and everything you have done for us. And I hope you will safely guide us all through this blessed Sabbath day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Amen. Wasn't that a wonderful story? Are we walking around with our sins this morning? Amen. 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 God has paid the ultimate sacrifice. At this time, it is time for our tithes and offering. Amen. Amen. All right. Don't get so quiet now, everyone. Amen. You can participate in our tithes and offering. And there are four ways that we can do it. You can give by mail. Please don't send any monies through the mails. You can give online through AdventistGiving.org, or you can go up to SWPSDA, and there you can do that. You can give by our Cash App. Has anybody used the Cash App? Okay, all right. We have some technologically advanced people that are donating by Cash App. And then if you need, or you can give it in person,
you that are here. And so this morning, or if you need someone to come and pick it up, just call the main number, and elder or deacon will come and collect your tithes and offering. Also, I want to let you know that the envelopes are here. They are yellow envelopes that are looking like this. Really nice with names and stuff like that. So please remember the Pathfinders as you give. So musicians are going to give us some giving music this morning. Amen. All right. Amen. Amen.
Amen. So this song came to my spirit. We got some money that needs to be raised for our children. We got some healing that we're praying for in the house. But don't you know we serve a big God that can handle all of that, right? Amen. Amen.
I have a very big God. A very big God. Oh, he knows that for my house. He's always on my side. A very big God. I have a very big God. A very big God. Oh,
he knows it from
my hand. He's always on my side. A very big God.
I have a very big God.
A very big God. Oh,
he knows it from
my hand. He's always on my side, a very big God.
Come on, if you believe in God for something, come on, stand up in a place. Come on, we're going to call God to our situation, to whatever we need him to do this morning. We're going to sing this all together. Hallelujah, because we're believing God for something in the place.
I have a very big God.
I have a very big God.
There may be meat in mine house, and prove me herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven. We really need the Lord to open up those windows for us and to pour you out a blessing that there shall not be room enough to receive it. Let us pray. Father, we come before you thanking you for the ability that you have given so that we can obtain this money that you have given to us through jobs. We just thank you, Heavenly Father, for your blessings on us. And now as we come to return what you have asked us to do, we pray that you'll continue to bless this tithes and this offering. May it go towards the furthering of your work here on earth. And Father, bless all those who had to give and those who did not have to give. May they continue to hold on to you and to trust you, knowing that their blessing is sure. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' worthy name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen.
Praise God. to your right and look to your left. And say, thank you, Jesus. Why are you saying thank you, Jesus? You're thanking God for your brother or your sister. Just give God thanks. I want to let you know, yesterday at 10 o'clock, I was on the phone with Brother Ernie. And he was telling me he was at the stoplight. And then he said, something is happening. And the next thing I know, maybe the car is totally running his back. Just like that. I spoke to him last night. He's home, but he's in a lot of pain. And how, that's how the devil works. But I come here this morning to let you know he's a liar. I come here this morning to let you know that God is able. I come here this morning to remind us, whatever it is, look to the cross. So this morning, as you assume your prayer posture, I'll tell you, don't look at me this morning. Look to the cross. In your mind's eye, see the cross. For that's where, from where our healing comes. That's where our victory comes from. And as the praise seems, remind us as we're praised. Praise is what we give. Let's tune our hearts. Forget the things around us, the car payment, the notes and everything, and focus just this moment and the love and the mercy of God.
Praise is what I do when I wanna be close to you. I lift my hands in praise. Praise is who I am. I will praise him while I can. Bless him at all times, and I vow to praise you through the good and the bad. I'll praise you whether happy or sad. In all that I go through, because praise is what I do, 'cause I owe it all to you.
Eternal Father and our God, we as a people mindful, and we are thankful that you are the Lord of our lives. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the mercies you have given to us. We thank you, Lord, for life. We thank you for health and strength. We thank you, God, that we are here this morning in your house. Praise. God, as we come, may we bow our knees, our heart, Lord, and we bow our knees right now. God, we come, and there's so much tension. There's trouble in the church, trouble in our homes, trouble in the world, trouble in our country. And sometimes, God, we wonder, when will it all end? For the people of God, we see that trials and tribulation will come. Sometimes we reach a point of wondering, when and how will it all end? But we come here this morning, and the profession of our faith, believing that you are still the God who holds this world in your hand. So God, we come this morning and we throw ourselves at your foot at the cross. As we come and as we kneel at the cross, we look up and there we see you high and lifted up. And you are willing to draw us all closer to you. Father God, we come this morning as a church. And we have sickness, we have pain, we have sorrow. We can mention by name those among us who are sick at this time. Those who are bereaved at this time. Families. Oh God, we come to you seeking mercy and grace. Father God, we pray for the Matthias family. Pray for the Simmons family. Pray for Sister Grant and her family. And all those who are mourning have suffered the loss of a loved one. God, be merciful. Then we talk about, Lord Jesus, those among who are sick, Brother Ernie right now. And we mention in our thoughts right now, has entered into our spirit, Brian McCleary. God, you know all things. You know all persons. You know everything. We know you are the God of today, tomorrow, the God of the past and the future. But we are just here in this moment and this time right now. And so, Father God, we come to you seeking a refuge. But we believe and we accept the teachings of your word. That we come to you in no wise cast us out. So, Father God, here we come this morning, asking you to be merciful in all things. Thou who knows the beginning from the end, those who have created all men and all things according to your will and your purpose, we lift up all those who are bereaved and all those who are sick before you this morning. And Lord God, we simply say, have your way, as only you can. And Lord, help us at the end of it all to remain faithful to you, remembering always to give you thanks and to give you praise, because you're God all by yourself. Lord God, we thank you for the moment we have in your house today. May we experience you as we have never experienced you before. Astonish us again, Lord Jesus, as only you can. And so God, we lift up now the person you have chosen to break the bread of life to us. Oh God, we ask you now to have your way with him, Lord Jesus. May we see you. Though he speak to us, we might see you high and lifted up today. God, we seek forgiveness of all our sins and our shortcomings. Continue to help us. Help. Continue, Lord Jesus. Keep us as a church and as a family. That they say that family that stays together, stick together, stays together. We want, Lord Jesus, to be mindful of each other, remembering that we are here to help each other make it to the kingdom. So, God, help us that as we worship today, we might do so in spirit and in truth. Bless us to this end, we pray. In Jesus' name, and the church say amen. Amen.
Praise is what I do. It's what I do. Praise is what I do. It's what I do.
I invite you to stand with me as we open the Word of God. This morning, our passage comes to us from 1 Samuel, chapter 18, verses 1 through 7. Let me say, hear you say amen. It's on the screen if you have it. I'll read in your hearing, and you can follow. And it says, and it came to pass, when he had made an end of speaking unto Saul, that the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. And Saul took him that day and would let him go no more home to his father's house. Verse 3, then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that he was upon him and gave it to David, and his garment even to his sword and to his bow and his girdle. Verse 5 says, and David went out whithersoever Saul sent him, and behaved himself wisely. And Saul sent him over to the men of war, and he was accepted in the sight of all the people, and also the sight of Saul's servant. And it came to pass, as they came, when David was returned from the slaughter of the Philistine, that the women came out all of all cities of Israel, singing and dancing, to meet King Saul with the trumpets and with joy and with instruments of music. Verse 7, and the women answered one another as they played and said, Saul has slain his thousand and David his 10,000. And the reading of the word of the Lord. Church, say amen. Amen.
It is my pleasure to introduce our speaker, and certainly I am fully aware of who he is and where he came from. He's a young man that grew up in the rural country of Virginia, somewhat similar to I in North Carolina. We both know how to chop wood and how to cut down trees, but I'm grateful that he also know how to play baseball on a field that had no grass, amen. For those of y'all don't know, he and I know. But nevertheless, I'm just glad that he has the opportunity to come to us. His family and I, my family, we have been kind of interwoven for some time now since we kidnapped him from the Lake Region Conference. But his daughter, in fact, his daughter and son-in-law are my and Robin's grandsons, godparents. And so we have been at both of their daughters' weddings. We're just waiting for ours, amen. And so we can invite others to come and we can watch her say I do. But nevertheless, I'm just glad that we have traveled this journey for some time now. I would want to say since 2000, and since he came to Allegheny East Conference, and I've watched him maturate throughout his journey here with us to the point that he is now presently, we voted October the 22nd for him to be president of the Allegheny East Conference. And now we find out in March of 2024, he has been selected to be president of the Columbia Union Conference. So he goes from being the president of one conference to eight conferences under his umbrella. And I wouldn't wish that on anybody, amen. But I'm just grateful that he is, as they say, above all of that, and all the accolades and all the degrees that I could tell you he has, and all of the training, what I can say is he's a humble man, and he's a God-fearing man, and he loves his wife. Amen. Sister Mary Ann is here. You can just wave your hand, Sister Mary Ann. Amen. And I don't know how many times we have driven together And sometimes he would get a little rambunctious. And another friend and I would always say, call Mary Ed. But praise the Lord. It was that kind of a relationship we had. So after this special music from my praise team. Amen. The voice that you will hear is that of Dr. Marcellus T. Robinson.
Amen. I love these words. There's a part of the line that says, no one can worship him for me. Amen. For all the things he's done for me. Amen. So I want you to just get your for me in your head. I'm going to get mine in my head, and we're going to worship him all together. Amen. Amen.
You, Lord, you are worthy, and no one can worship you for me. For all the things you've done for me, and no one can worship you for me. Here's my worship, all of my worship. Receive my worship. All of my worship, here's my worship. All of my worship.
Come on, that's a personal thing. Receive,
receive my worship.
This is your own conversation. All of mine.
All of my worship.
Come on, say, you, Lord.
You, Lord. You are worthy.
Anybody know he's worthy this morning? Hallelujah. And no one,
no one can worship you for me.
Come on, just think back. Think back of all the things.
All the things you've done for me.
Hallelujah, Jesus. And no one,
no one can worship you for me. Worship, all of my worship.
Hallelujah. Receive my
worship.
All of my
worship.
Hallelujah. Here it is.
Here's my worship.
All of my
worship.
Hallelujah. Receive my
worship.
My body, God. I'm going
always worship you.
Thank you, God, as long as I'm breathing.
As long as I am
breathing. I give it all to you, God.
Is he really worthy this morning? Is he really worthy this morning? Hallelujah. Is he really worthy this morning? Come on, give him your worship this morning. Give him your praise this morning. Give him all that you have this morning. Come on, those words said, and I will not be silent. God, I will always worship you. God, as long as I'm breathing, I will always worship you, worship you. Give your name glory, give your name. And I
will
sit on my back. Come on, if you won't be silent on him this morning, give him your worship. I will always give you glory. I'm gonna lift up my hand. I'm gonna give the glory and give your honor.
Praise the Lord. I want to thank the praise team for leading us in our praise this morning. What a mighty God we serve, amen. He's been good to you this week. Woke you up this morning, clothed you in your right mind, amen. Brought us out to his house of worship that we might praise him. I want to thank your pastor, my friend, Pastor Blackwell, Earl Blackwell, and Robin and the elders and the members of this church for your hospitality toward Marianne and I shown already today. We go to some churches and there is no parking space. Came here, there's a parking space right up front. That's nice. Thank you. That's kind of you. You know, and I say that because we need to thank God for the little things of life. Amen. I thank God for these musicians who are playing today. Amen. I asked your pastor, I said, is this your group? He said, oh, every last one of them. And the praise team, I said, my God, y'all been blessed here, haven't you? Amen. And then to see these young people, Lord have mercy. What a joy. You have young and old alike, different walks of life. God has really blessed Southwest, amen. And let us remember to keep Brian in prayer, Elder McClary's son. That's unexpected. But nothing is too hard for God to do, amen?
I'm trying to get myself together because you got to understand, yesterday, this time I was catching a plane from Chicago back this way to Baltimore. And I've been out in Michigan all week. We've been interviewing pastoral candidates at the seminary. It's been a wonderful week in fellowship and with the young men and women there at the seminary. And then to come home, catch the drive up the road from Baltimore to Pottstown. And then I haven't seen my wife all week and close and personal. I got to see her last night, praise God. I got in at what, 10:20, I believe. And we talked to one something in the morning. You know, just talking about the goodness of the Lord. But I'm here, and I'm sorry I had anticipated being with you all day today. So that means I have to come back. Amen. Amen. We have some communication business to take care of that I promised this church. And one thing, if I make a promise, I plan to keep that promise. Amen. But today we come to worship God. Is that all right? Amen. And he is worthy of our worship. The title of my sermon is In Search of a Friend. And you'll find out why I chose that title in a few minutes. But this time, let us pause in prayer and seek God's blessings. Father, we have come to praise you today. You are God. You are Father. There's nothing that comes to you by surprise. Many times we come acting as if you don't know, but you already know. You've anticipated our need and you provide for us. And now we ask that you anticipate our need and we stand in need of your word right now. So use your servant to deliver the word that you've given me for your people this day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now, I'm not going to promise you I'm going to be short because I make those promises I tend not to keep because I get caught up in the spirit, praising God. But I am going to tell you, I'm going to share with you what God has put on my heart today. We live in some troublesome times right now. It's sad what's going on in our world. You expect adults to act like adults, not like children. You expect your political leaders to have some type of sense of sobriety and not act ignorant and stoke up fear in the hearts of people. We are supposed to alleviate fear, not strike up fear. Amen? And as Christians, we are to represent Christ in all walks of life. Amen? And speak the truth and shame the devil, as they say. At least that's what they told me when I was growing up. But I'm finding out people don't grow up like you. So you got to be true to God, the God that you know. And I want to thank the Seventh-day Adventist Church for teaching me to read the Bible for myself and live according to the convictions that God has brought to my heart from his word for myself. I want to thank the Seventh-day Adventist Church for helping me to understand that I need to read my Bible. Amen? Amen. And that I need to have a personal walk with God for myself. At least I become a castaway. Amen? Now, my daddy told me, I don't care what color a person is, you check them out for yourself, son. Not based upon what somebody else has to say. Amen? Especially nowadays. Amen. And so today I wanted to go to a glimpse of scripture to help us understand that if you want a real friend, and most people want a real friend. Amen. And when you get a real friend, you don't need that many real friends. You can count them on one hand when you got a real friend. And you understand today as we go through the word. So if you have a pen and paper, or, you know, might want to use your device and you type it in. Type down these scriptures that I share with you today and then go back and read them for yourself and reflect on them and let God speak to your heart when it comes to being a friend to someone. Amen. But starting off the bat, I want to share a thought with you that I've discovered in 2008 when I was working on some material called Friendship Evangelism. And there was one thing that struck me in 2008. It said that loneliness was the number one disease of the decade. Loneliness is the biggest problem in America today, but you can't fight it by following the simple plan to beat it. Millions of people say and feel lonely today, but they aren't sure why they are lonely, and they don't know what they can do to make themselves feel better, said Harvard psychiatrist Wilm S. Appleton. But nowadays, I found out today, the number one problem in the world is loneliness. Because of the pandemic and the wars and the devastation that has happened in diverse places and circumstances, people are lonely. I believe people are lonely in this church today. If you take time to get to know somebody, I find out that preachers aren't exempt from loneliness. I saw a preacher not too long ago, just last month. We were walking somewhere and his head was downcast, and I was walking with a friend and we looked at him and said, "Hey man, you all right?" "All right." He wasn't all right. He was lonely. He was downcast. He was dealing with a situation that he couldn't handle. Sound like somebody you know? Anybody in here got some situations you brought in here today that you can't handle? If you did, you're in the right place. I want you to know that today. Yeah, there are situations that come up that you don't anticipate, but they're waiting on you. I got a call this morning. I mean, not a call, but somebody texted me this morning, before 7 o'clock this morning. I told you I went to bed after 1, and I got a text at 7. I wasn't anticipating that text. They said, "I've been trying to get a hold of you this week. I know you're busy. But I need your help." And so after I read the text, I prayed. Because I said, "Lord, have mercy for what they put in the text." And then I was thankful the Lord didn't allow me to know that they were trying to reach me until this morning. I have to be honest, folks. You know, God knows what you're dealing with and what you can handle and when you can handle it. Amen? And so this person was in need of a friend. And they were reaching out to me to help them in their situation. But I knew that based upon what they shared with me as a friend, I couldn't help them with the situation. There's a process they have to go through to get to me because they talk coming to me as the president, amen? But there are situations that happen in your life that I said, I got to follow protocol just like you, amen? And hopefully it won't get to me. It'll be resolved before it get to me. But I told you I did something. I prayed first, amen? After praying the prayer, I reached out to the pastor that was referred to in the text. Yeah, that means a member and a pastor having a little problem here in the Sabbath morning. And I'm getting up to review the message for the day, and I get this unexpected text from a child of God crying out for help. Amen? Yeah, and I'm praying, "Lord, you got to work your thing now." So I called the pastor to ask the pastor, "Hey, what happened last night? Because I got a text here saying something happened." And the pastor articulated his account of what happened. And the sad thing is both of them agree. Well, I should say a good thing. Both of them agree on the details, what was done. But there was a breach in the relationship. Amen. And so I'm praying, "Lord, you got to help fix this." Now, you know I can't just run down there and deal with it, even though I would love to, but I can't. And so the pastor told me, though, he reached out to the right person and told him what happened. And I said, "Okay, you talk to the right person, then I'm sure that person going to follow up on it." And sure enough, it's while I was talking to the pastor, the person texted me and said, "Yeah, Pastor so-and-so talked to me this morning. I'm okay. Enjoy your day." I've learned, people, there are a lot of things we let blow up because we don't go to the right friend with the situation. Now, I might be the president of the conference and the president of the union, but there's somebody more authoritative than I am. His name is Jesus. And he's waiting on a call from us because he can handle any situation or circumstance at any time. Isn't that right? And then, now imagine how I felt when I'm talking to the pastor. I said, Pastor, I'm glad you called Pastor so-and-so because it's been worked out. Well, what's been worked out is the person is calmed down and realizing that the situation will be handled. Amen? But the thing is, you got to go to the right friend at the right time, folks. We live in a world, man, where folk act like they're your friends, and they are. But I just want to share with you four levels of friendship. And then I want to speak about that fourth one in particular this morning before I leave here. Because I want to keep you safe and sound in your relationships with other people. Amen? I found out that your association with the wrong people can cause you unnecessary trouble in your life. Mm-hmm. What are you talking about, Pastor? Now, first level of friendship, and I used to teach children this in school, go by the schools and teach them different levels of friendship, because I read a quotation from our dear friend, Sister White, that said you need to teach your children how to cultivate the right relationships with people so that they won't be led astray. Now, I'm talking to somebody in here today. You know exactly what I'm talking about. You had a friend that you associated with. You thought they were your friend or your real friend, and you found out that they weren't your real friend. They just used you for what they wanted. And then they dropped you off and went on about their business. And then you are left in destitute and hurt over the situation. And sometimes it don't have to be a boyfriend-girlfriend relationship. It can be a boy-boy relationship or a girl-girl relationship. You're just looking for a friend, but you found the wrong friend. Well, in my study, I found out there are four types of relationships. First of all, there's the initial relationships where we get to introduce ourselves to one another. And like, I'm Marcellus Tyrone Robinson. That's right. That's my name. The position I hold is president of Allegheny East Conference and Columbia Union Conference. Amen? But my name, the person I am, I'm from Cumberland County, Virginia. Do you know where Cumberland County, Virginia is? Anybody in here know where it is? I get no takers. Nobody raised their hand. Oh, you know where it is? You were born in Virginia. You know where Cumberland is? Where is it? Oh, man. 50 miles southwest of Richmond. That's right. In the country. No stoplights. Out in the boondocks. You leave Richmond, hey, you better get some food. You better get your calls in, because by the time you get to Cumberland, you ain't no necessarily, you're going to get a connection on your phone even to the day. We are next to a place called Farmville. Thank you, sir, for helping me out this morning. But, you know, the initial thing is you introduce yourself to somebody and you just become, you know, initial friends, just sharing a little initial information. Amen. Now, when we just meet like that, and you, I'm Marcellus Robinson, and you Southwest Church, you know, and then when I get to know your names, I don't need to give you my deep secrets. Amen? Why? Because we don't have that kind of relationship. Amen? Uh-huh. I know when, you know, I came in here as president, I'd be better off coming in here without that title. Because you'd be more willing to receive me if you don't know my title, see? Depending on your relationship with presidents, you see? But you would have to deal with me just as a person. So the first level of friendship is the initial relationship where you just introduce yourself to one another. Second level of friendship is socialization. You know, where you socialize with people based on your social relationship. You know, there are some people who don't mind drinking juice together or eating ice cream together. You see what I'm saying? Or going shopping together. Or reading books together. Doing some type of social interaction. That's another type of relationship or friendship. Amen? That's a social friend. Now, with the social friend, do I tell them my deep secrets? No! We don't have that kind of relationship. We just like playing ball together, like reading books together, like watching TV programs together. But just because we do that, don't expect me to come visit you in the hospital when you get sick. But in my experience in the life of the church, there are people upset in the church because they had social friends who didn't come to visit them in the hospital. And when I go to visit them, Pastor, I don't know why such and such didn't come to see me. They know I'm in the hospital. Then I go back and see your friend that you've been blasting out because they didn't come see you in the hospital. And I ask him, I said, your friend in the hospital? Yeah, they my friend. We play this together and we do that together, but I ain't going to no hospital now, Pastor. I said, why not? Last time I was in the hospital, my mama died there. I ain't going back to no hospital. I love them, but I don't love them that much. And they're speaking the truth in love. You know what I'm saying? But then come communion time, we can't even talk to each other because you didn't visit me when I was in the hospital. But I didn't tell you I was going to visit you in the hospital either. I just told you we're going to go out and eat some ice cream together or go shopping together. But I didn't tell you I'm going to visit you in the hospital now. I'm just trying to help somebody in here in my short time here. Because some of y'all need to go back and apologize to each other. Y'all still friends. You just ain't them deep friends. You see what I'm saying? And then what if I have a phobia about hospitals? I'm just being honest about it now. Just because you have time, Pastor, don't mean you ain't scared. Y'all all right here this morning? Oh, you mad some pastor. They ain't coming to a hospital to visit you. They send the elder or the deacon or somebody else. But they ain't coming. Because they scared. Y'all all right? Well, that's the truth now. Some of y'all smiling. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I had a friend one time. He came to do a week of prayer, and we took him to the hospital to visit some saints. On the way to the next place, he said, man, how do you do it? I said, do what? How do you go to the hospital and visit these people? I said, I just pray and ask God to be with me. He said, what, you ain't scared? I said, of course I'm scared. But I ain't scared enough not to do what the Lord say do. I give it to Jesus. But that person need to see me. I'm their pastor. Amen? Amen. There ain't nothing like the pastor coming up in there. And by the way, before I go see the person in the hospital, I stop by the desk and check in. Why are you doing that? Because I don't know what they're dealing with. Am I right or wrong? I'm just trying to get some tips here. The elder up here, he just laughing. You know, there's a little things we need to learn. Don't just walk up in there like you know what's going on. You don't know what's going on up in there. You don't know what happened that day in that person's life. You stop at the nursing station. So I'm here to visit so-and-so. Is anything I need to be made aware of before I go in the room? I'm here just to be a blessing. Now, when I do that as a pastor, you know what the nurse said? We so glad you came. We trying to get them to take this medication, Pastor, and they won't do it. They need this medication, Pastor. Can you get them to take this medication, Pastor? Yeah. These brothers laugh because they know I'm telling the truth. And I say, I do my best. And I go up and I say, Sister So-and-so, how are you today? I don't know, Pastor. I don't know. You know, they ain't treat me right up in here. And I don't know why I'm here. I'm ready to go home, Pastor. Can you get me out of here to go home? I said, Sister So-and-so, before they can release you, they got to treat you. Is that all right? If you say so, Pastor. Pastor, they're trying to get me to take this medicine. Do you think I need to take this medicine? I said, Sister, I believe you can trust them with that medicine. They're just trying to get you well so you can get up out of here. Okay, Pastor, I hear what you're saying. Okay. I said, now, do you mind if I call that nurse in here and I stand here with you while you take the medicine? Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. Now, the doctor who prescribed can't get them to take it. So they need a friend that they know and they trust to help them through this diresome circumstance. Amen? And based on that relationship with this pastor who ain't no doctor and don't know what that medicine can or cannot do, I only know what the nurses and doctors tell me. Amen? Because I ain't got time to go and Google it and look it up. And even if I did that, I still wouldn't understand it. All I know is they're in a relationship to help you get better. And I encourage you to do what they say. Take your medicine and get well so you can get up out of here. Because they don't want you up in here either. It's not a safe place to get well. That ain't no place to recuperate. You do that at home, not in no hospital. Too many diseases up in there that you can catch unexpectedly. Amen? Amen. And so based upon what I say, to first take the medicine, then the doctor, he ain't got no ego. He said, thank you, Pastor. Now, I will extend your visiting privilege 24/7. Now, that's been my experience. I said, what? Yeah, you can come up in here anytime you feel like it because you're on my team helping this person get well. Am I speaking truth up in here today? Y'all know I'm telling the truth. Then there's that close friend who's born out of adversity that Proverbs talking about. In Proverbs 17:17, the friend who loves at all times is better than a brother is born for adversity or from adversity. You have a situation. Accident happened unexpectedly and somebody rolled up on you and said, can I help? You're in a crisis. You don't know this person from Adam. God sent this person along to help you in your need. And then in the person helping you in the middle of your crisis, you exchange information, friendship information, that initial information, and then the person call and check up on you later and say, you all right? You know what I'm saying? The Lord sent that person your way. You didn't even ask for him to come. God knew what you needed and he expected your situation before it occurred. And he sent the right person to be a friend to you so that he can take care of you out of that situation. Am I making sense in here this morning? I'm about finished because I ain't going to keep, you know, I know y'all looking at that clock. And you're, some of you probably hungry about now. So a real friend won't stand between you and your food. Am I speaking the truth in here this month? Amen. My daddy told me don't take too long because I'm up old now, but I got to do certain things at a certain time. Now, you can't keep me tearing all night long. Now, you get caught up in the spirit, and then, you know, I have an accident, and there's going to be a problem up in here. Am I speaking the truth? We need to learn to enjoy our experience with God and one another. Life is too short. All you have is today. You're not promised tomorrow. You've been promised eternity by God. But you have been promised tomorrow. All you have is today. Now to that last level of friendship, that changed relationship. I'm so glad you asked me about that one. That final one. Well, I found it in 1 Samuel chapter 18. Three people, Saul, David, and John. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Saul happens to be the king of Israel. Am I right? And then Jonathan is his son. He be the prince of Israel. Amen. David, he just a shepherd boy. Boy, I tell you, God got a sense of humor when you read the word now. God ain't hung up on your position. God is hung up on your relationship with him. Boy, I tell you. I mean to tell you the person who has the best relationship with God is the most powerful person in this church. It ain't based on your position. It's based on your relationship with Jehovah. Yes, sir. As long as we understand that, then the last time I checked when I wake up this morning, Jehovah woke me up. And if he woke me up, I said, thank you, Lord, for waking me up this morning and give me another day. Amen. By the time I get to church, man, I'm ready to rock and roll for Jesus. You're supposed to be praising him when you wake up in the morning. Yeah, praise him for the pain you feel. Some folk can't even feel the pain. I guess you didn't expect this sermon, type of sermon from the president, huh? But I'm his humble servant, and I just got to deliver what he put on my heart to deliver. So here it is, Jonathan has been praying for his daddy. His daddy's in a fix. There's somebody called Goliath who done put out a challenge for Israel. You send your champion to meet me down here in the valley, And we're going to settle this beef between your nation and my nation. And whoever wins, they rule. Mm-hmm. David heard about it, coming to serve his brothers, right? And then his brothers got mad, said, mind your business and get back there and tend those sheep. But David hears the problem and said, what, ain't nobody going to deal with this brother? Talking bad about my God? Somebody need to deal with this brother. See, David has some experience with a lion and a bear. He's had experience with God out there on that backside taking care of them sheep. When there ain't nobody out there but David and sheep and wolves and lions and tigers and bears. Oh, my. Yeah, David, but he done learned something. While he out there tending the sheep, he learned how to write poetry to God. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. That's something. He can write some stuff about God that nobody else has heard before because he has time to spend with God. He ain't complaining about being lonely because he ain't lonely. God is with him wherever he is. Do you know God like that? See, the problem is we know about God, but do you know it? That's when it makes a difference in your life. That fake religion ain't gonna work nowadays. God gonna flush you out. Either you know him or you don't. Well, David has been there and seen God use him to slay a bear and a lion. What is Goliath to him? He's seen God work through him. And he said, somebody need to deal with this brother. His brother told you need to mind your business, boy, and go back and tend the sheep. So I heard about it and said, bring him here. So I said, well, you think you can? And then David told him his story. Look, man, my application said, God, take care of lion, take care of bear, take care of Goliath. That's what my application read. Uh-huh. And then he said, okay, well, I'll take my armor. Then David tried it on, said, don't fit. He said, I think I got all I need. My sling, the rocks, and God. That's all I need. Just show it. Just point the way to him. David goes out there. Goliath talking all cussing and fussing and faking and fooling and thinking and laughing at him. That's what you sent out here? This little runt? And what he going to do? Then they got engaged in battle, and next thing you know, the giant fell down, and David took his big sword and took it out from the giant and took his sword and cut his head off after you hit him with that rock. Uh-huh. Now, that ain't in no manual. It's called on-the-job training with God. So he took the head back. And that's where you find this thing picking up. Now, when he had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. Saul took him that day and would not let him go home to his father's house anymore. Did you get that? You do things for God? God got plans for you that you don't anticipate. David was expecting to go back home, but Saul said, nope, you staying here. I got plans for you. Isn't that right? Now imagine now the shock on David's face that he can't go back home. He got to stay with Saul in the king's palace. And then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan took off the robe that was on him and gave it to David. And his armor, and even his sword, his bow, and his belt. Good night. This boy's giving David everything he has of value. Because he wants to enter into a change relationship with David. He said, this is the kind of man I need to be in my life to be a friend to me. One who has my back. One who has put his life on the line for my father. And because of his exploits, my father still lives. Stop listening to folk that's doing all that talking. and no actions are shown. That's what my father was talking about. People talk a good game, but watch people's actions. So David went out wherever Saul sent him and behaved wisely. And Saul set him over the men of war, and he accepted in the sight of all the people and on the sight of all of Saul's servants. Look at him, how he elevated them just like that. God did this thing. David didn't anticipate it. He wasn't even seeking it. But God gave it to him. Amen? And then notice here, the scripture goes on and says that now it had happened that they were coming home. When David was returning from the slaughter of the Philistines, that the women had come out of all the cities of Israel singing and dance to meet King Saul with tambourines, with joy, and musical instruments. Yeah, boy. And the women sang as they danced and said, Saul has slain his what? Thousands. But David has his what? 10,000. Yeah, and notice, then they ain't got number two lines in the song. Saul has slain his thousand, and David his what? 10,000. And Saul is listening to him. I can count. Now, who would expect the man invited them into his home? And yet, when he hear folk giving accolades to the boy more so than him, all of a sudden his attitude changes toward David. Who would have thought? Somebody in here know what I'm talking about. Oh, Lord. So your friend got the promotion you want. Or should I say the office in the church that you want? Make it more plain, you know. And you know I've been wanting to be an elder a long time. And then they had the audacity to ask you to be an elder. And they know I want to be an elder. And you're still not an elder. Maybe you're not doing the work of an elder. Maybe it is all you're doing is talking about being an elder. But if you did the work of an elder, then maybe they'll make you an elder. Amen? While somebody else ain't doing no talking, they just doing the work. I took my glasses off. I can't see nothing but blur in here. I took my glasses off for a reason, so you can't accuse me. I was looking, you were looking at me when you said that. You know, after the sermon, that's what they say. When God is speaking to your heart, and I'm going to deliver the word as he told me. Now, and I'm going to tell you, afterward, don't be mad at me transferring your anger to me when you're angry at God now. I ain't scared. Yeah, let me go on. Anyway, David, and then Saul was very angry, and the saying displeased him. And he said, they have ascribed to David 10,000. And to me, they have ascribed only what? 1,000. Now, what more can he have but what? The kingdom. So Saul eyed David from that day forward. You know, he gave him the evil eye. He told him, I got my eye on you, boy. Watch yourself now. Now the fact is, David didn't actually go to his house. He told him he wanted him there. Then you bring the man in your house and then you despise. You need a friend. Because your family in there is just the king and his family and his servants. Am I right? Oh, you need a friend now. But thank God, God had prepared David a friend. Jonathan was his friend. Oh, yeah, boy, isn't that good news? God knows what you need and when you need it. Amen? Now, I want to say this to you right now. And the friend God chooses for you might not be the one you expect. See, we want to choose the friend. Am I right or wrong? I'm looking up now, because I know I'm telling the truth up in here. This pastor, how you know? Because I've been there. I lived this thing. They're no novice to me. When I became a Seventh-day Adventist at 15, I had some friends in high school. They were a rough group. Yeah. Thank you, sir. I tell you, a friend know what you need. Ain't gonna let me cough all day. No, help me out now. And my mother started praying for me. See, because at 15, the Lord had given me a call to ministry. And I must confess, I didn't expect it, and I didn't want it. In fact, I told God, look at here now, you know I'm going to be an attorney, and I'm going to be a defense attorney. So I ain't down with that pastoral stuff. But God said, look at here, I'm God, you mine. I plead your case to the Father, you plead my case to the people. That's the way I see it. Now, you know what? He won, because I'm up here 50 years later, still preaching. Amen? But I'm saying, being honest, because somebody sitting out here today, God is talking to you. Where you are, and you don't want to hear it. But God got plans for you that you didn't anticipate. But God knows who you are and what you can do. And what he called you to do, he will equip you to do it. Go check the record. Moses, hello. 80-year-old man on the backside of the desert tending the sheep in retirement. And God said, yep, it's time. Moses, time for what? To go get my people. But I can't talk. He said, I know Aaron on the way to do your talking for you. Yeah, but I'm going to give you what to say, and then he going to speak to the people. What you tell it. Isn't that something? God anticipated the need. Then the Lord said, all I need to know, are you willing to do what I say? And then, by the way, just give me what you have. That's one thing I've learned in scripture. God never asks us to give us what he hasn't already given. Lord have mercy. But I find out people are more concerned about what they don't have than what God has given. And if you don't stop and think about what God has blessed you with, and then dedicate it back to God, and then tell God, use me in your service, you will never become a mighty warrior for God. You're too busy looking for stuff God never intended you to have. You don't need it, you just need God. I gotta wrap this thing up. How much time is it? I got caught up. I'm sorry. But I ain't sorry. You know. You know what I'm saying? That's a paradox. I'm sorry, but I ain't sorry. I ain't no ways tired, you know. But let me wrap this thing up. I did say I need to come back, right? And I think I can pick it up where I left off, too, when I come back here. But let me wrap this thing up right here now. Now notice here. David didn't ask for this. And you didn't ask for what you're going through. Let's be honest about this thing. God got you in a fix here that you didn't ask for. But he gave it to you. He designed it for you. He has plans for you that you know not of. But you got to trust him. You got to trust him. My heart goes out for, I need it, huh? Okay. Now I got two, thank you. And what David needs now is a friend. And when people going through hardships, they don't need lectures. They don't need condemnation. They need a friend who will hear them, who will listen to them, who will pray for them, who will encourage them. Oh, I need this. Oh, you want me to walk out? Yeah. it's on. Well, I'm all right right here. Y'all all right with me here? Okay. See, folk, notice in the scripture, he ain't got a lot of friends. Just need one good friend. One person who's committed to you no matter what. One person who's loyal to you no matter what. One person who is giving and forgiving no matter what. You don't need an entourage. Just need one. When I think about Jesus, you know, stretched up between heaven and earth on a cross, dying for you and for me. I'm still amazed. Because I say within myself, I don't see myself doing what he did. Nah. That's why I'm not him. He's who he is. He left glory for you and for me. If it was just one sinner on this place, he'd have did the same thing. See, we got to stay focused on who God is and what he means to us. God is your best friend. And I thank this church for teaching me that. As a teenager, I wasn't going to church. Didn't go to prayer meeting, didn't have a Bible. Yet while I was in sin, Christ prayed for me. And thank God, preacher came to town and said, hey, to the church family, go gather your children. I'm talking about the ones who are not here in church today and don't care to be here in church. I need you to gather those children and bring them here Wednesday night. And my mother came home from church and said, the pastor looking for you. And I remember telling her, I ain't looking for him. And she said, watch yourself, boy. Watch yourself. You going to church. You might not want to hear what he's going to say, but you're going to respect the man of God. You're going to go and hear what he has to say. So that Wednesday night, I was there with about 25 other kids. I said we wasn't going to church. We didn't have a Bible, so we wasn't reading what we don't have. Wasn't praying. But God had prayed for me and put on the heart of this preacher to reach out to his lost children, of which I was one. And then the man had the audacity that Wednesday night, said, I wonder why you think you're here. So you got that right. He said, well, we got work for you. I said, this preacher must be crazy. I don't go to church. Now you got work for me. Then he rolled, the deaconess came out there with those black pants and white shirt and black bow tie and a gold vest. Can you see yourself in that? Boy, I looked, I said, boy, I started smiling because I could see myself in that thing. That thing looked mighty sharp, you know. And see, the preacher know how to fix it just right. Can you see yourself in that? Boy, it's a visual. I could see myself. I caught the vision. And he said, well, We want you to be ushers in God's church. Now, I wasn't going to church. He wanted me to be an usher in the church. Yeah, what that mean? I had been baptized at 8. I was on the books, but I wasn't in the church. Sound familiar? But God sent a preacher to town who didn't give up on the lost. Because God left glory to seek those who are lost, that he might save them from sin. Isn't that right? That is the purpose of the church. At least God's church. And I never heard of that thing, man. Come on, put me to work. He said, we're going to train you a month, and then we're going to have you on duty here, and y'all going to be our junior ushers. He had a vision for the lost in the house of God. And I found myself ushering in God's house. But God wasn't through with me yet. No. My mother had the nerve to go up there to Brooklyn, New York, and join the Seventh-day Adventist Church. See, we were Baptists. And in the process, the Lord did a transformation in her life that only God could do. And when she came back home and that peace of God reigned in her life, you could see it. My God! And I said, Lord, I want what she got. Mercy. And mama said, you like what you said? Oh, I love it. Oh, I love it. Mama, you got a peace over you. There's a calmness to your soul. Never seen it before. Sure enough, love it. Sure enough, gotta have it. So I ran in the room and prayed to God. I said, God, give me what mama got. He said, oh, you don't want it. I said, yes, I do. Come on now, God. Don't hold out on me. He said, no, son. No, you understand that. It's going to cost you everything. I don't know if you won't do that. What you mean? I mean, you become mine, and I become your God. You serve me. I take care of your problems. But you must serve. And it will cost you everything. Not some things. Everything. I get to tell you where you go, when you go, where you go, and how you go. You willing to do that, son? Thought about it, and I said, yeah, I'm willing. Because I want what she got. Now ask me, do I regret it? Nope. And I'm still watching him do his thing. I'm still asking him, who am I supposed to speak to? Who am I supposed to help? Who am I supposed to encourage? For your name's sake today, Lord. You've been so good to me. I've been married to this wonderful woman over here for 44 years. I mean, to be married to me, she did fly on the wall. That long? Good night. And the days are getting sweeter as the days go by. We have two beautiful daughters and two beautiful sons who came into our lives through marriage. And then we have four grandchildren. Lord, I'm a rich brother. Mercy. My Lord, what a God we serve. And we all trying to figure out, who can we encourage today for you, Lord? Just need one friend. Will you try Jesus today? He loves you, you know. He won't forsake you. You can tell him whatever you're going through, and he'll keep. And he'll love you. He'll forgive you. And if you ask him, he will cleanse you. He will make you whole. And he'll take whatever you have and whoever you are, and design you just how he intends you to be. But it can't go against your will. He said, I stand at the door and knock. And in the Greek, it means this. Until you let him in, guess what? You have to answer. And only when you open the door of your heart can he come in. Many believe yet don't receive. So your friend is knocking at your door today. His name is Jesus. So tell me your problem. He can fix it. Tell me your care. I'm more than willing to heal you. My grace is sufficient for you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Do you need a friend like that today? If you need Jesus in your life today, I ask you to stand right where you are. If you're like me, you say, "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just upon his promise, just to know the sin of Lord. I trust him. Standing today, if you have not received Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, and Christ is speaking to your heart today and saying, my child, you can trust me, give me your life and I will exchange my life for your life, and the peace of God will be yours. Give me your wretched life and I will give you eternal life. And if you should die today, we will meet in God's kingdom. Give me what you have. And watch me give you a purpose, and you'll never look back. there such a one here today? Man, woman, boy, girl, Christ is speaking to your heart and saying, give me your life, and I will give you my life. Anybody willing to take him up on the offer today? Just raise your hand right where you are. I see your hand in the back, sir. God bless you. I'm going to pray for you. Anyone else? Now, the second appeal is for those you've given your life to Christ, but you got sidetracked somewhere. You lost your focus. And God is not first place in your life, and you need to confess. Lord, forgive me. And I ask that you would take me. Take me and lead me, Lord, from this place forward. Is there one like that in here today? You like that? Finally, you've given your life to Christ. You just want to say, lead on, King Jesus. Lead on until I see you face to face. Is there one like that in here today? Father in heaven, we're the one standing in the need of prayer. And you have prayed for us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Christ, our elder brother, for praying for us today. And so, Lord, your children have raised their hands toward you. Receive them unto yourself. To the young man who raised his hand, who wants to commit his life to you and want the exchange that you offer granted today. And may your peace fill him to overflowing. It won't stop problems from coming, but it will give him the answer he needs for every problem. In you, for you are the problem solver. And now, Lord, for your saints who got sidetracked and want to be refocused, grant them that request. It starts with simply say, Lord Jesus, forgive me. Cleanse me. Fill me with your spirit. And may I be ever mindful of your presence in my life. You lead me, you guide me, you direct me, and I will follow. With joy and gladness in my heart, I will follow you all the way. Now, Lord, to those saints who've been welcoming you with you sometime now, they rededicate their lives to you, that soon and so very soon they will see you face to face. But until then, may we model your love and grace to the people who walk the streets of Philadelphia or wherever we go. And may they see in us you, Lord. And may we provide the healing and the help, whatever they need. Because freely we have received, freely we shall give. Thank you, Lord, for the time we spent together in your presence today. In Jesus' name we pray. Let his people say. Thank you.
all stand. The church say amen. Church say amen. God is good all the time. We just want to give praise and honor to God for the word he has placed in our hearts today. Let us continue to seek a good friend. Shall we bow our heads? Father God, we thank you for your mercy and your grace. Thank you, Lord, for the word you have put in our spirit today. Thank you for the preacher. And to bless him, bless his wife, bless his family. Continue to bless his forward movement as you see fit. Lord Jesus, as we leave this place, may we ponder the word we listen to today and may it be a path of our continued growth in you. We say thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for worshiping with us today. Please like and subscribe, post a comment, or leave a prayer request. Until next time, God bless.